thank you. Thank you, everyone, for participating in today's workshop. First, we want to thank the youth for coming out, a couple of athletes from Romeoville High School participating on this panel and helping us out. So thank you guys for coming. We want to thank Mayor John Noak for coming out to support us today, our Romeoville Village Mayor. Kelly Reiser, the athletic supervisor, director for the Village of Romeoville. We have a really exciting panel and a great discussion. Big time event for you students to really learn some things and get a chance to meet some of the officers in the community and just get their input on some interesting topics that pertain to youth violence throughout the world, throughout our community. That's what our topic is for today. And I thought this was a great topic, especially for athletes that I work with that have been a part of Opportunity Matters the last couple years. We've experienced some violence in our own schools, in our own communities. And you know, my athletes and I talk about stuff like this all the time. I thought it'd be good to get our panel in to help us out. So to introduce our panel, first and foremost, we have a couple officers from Romeoville PD. We have Police Chief Crow from Romeoville PD. We have Commander Anderson from Romeoville PD. We have Officer Tevin Teamer from Romeoville PD. And then we have a special guest from Villa Park, Cordell Kitching. He's an officer. Unique story about him and Mr. Anderson. They're both Alpha Phi Alpha fraternity members. So I thought that would be something that we can even talk about that a little bit and how that relates. So that's pretty cool. And then we got some guys throughout the community that are major, major, you know, role models and mentors in our Romeoville community. First, we have Coach Joe Johnson with the Ice Fire. A lot of you guys know him from the High Point facility and the things he does in the community. And then we also have Pastor Chris Hudson, who's active all throughout the community, working with the police department, working with the High Point community. Some of you guys have met him as well. So what we wanted to talk about here when it pertains to youth violence, you know, we have seen fights in the school year, right? We have seen shootings throughout the country with high school students walking into high schools and doing those unfortunate things. And we have seen just violence just in our neighborhoods, whether it be gang violence or you name it. So we wanted to talk to you guys about that, get your opinion on that, and just work through that and, you know, get your thoughts on what triggers that. So the first question, we're gonna do a couple questions. You know, some of you guys have participated in this. It's always a fun deal. The first question we have for you, is what do you think causes teens to act out aggressively, you know, in their communities and throughout the world? What's causing that? Does anybody, you raised your hand, what you got? Say it again, please. Lack of support at home. Lack of support at home, he says. Anyone else got it? What they're seeing on social media. So we have a lack of support at home, what they're seeing on social media. Anything else? There's no wrong answer. So how we're gonna go with that, we're gonna first talk about social media and we're gonna talk about a lack of support at home. So how I wanna do it is we're gonna let someone from the panel address, guys, social media. So social media, we'll talk about that topic. Social media is a triggering violence in school and in the community. How's it triggering that violence, right? My biggest question, you say social media is triggering that. What is it doing, people? How are we taking social media issues into the classroom? Does anybody know?
I think maybe like cyberbullying might, like if you got bullied before, you might come in like with a little bit more anger than somebody who else, like who hasn't been bullied, or like how things escalate on the internet.
OK. Okay, so panel, this is how we involve you. Any of you guys have any experience with dealing with cyberbullying issues and addressing those?
All right, I'm going to take a pass. I had a thought on social media. I'll let somebody else handle an expert handle cyberbullying. I know we got some SROs up here that have done some cyberbullying.
Well, with cyberbullying, I try to put myself in your shoes, being as far as what you're exposed to with social media. It glorifies it, and it's times 100, if not more. So what that does to an adolescent brain, you react versus thinking about the consequences on how to handle it. So, you know, that's why it's important to reach out and say something. If we don't say anything, when I was in the schools, I would tell the kids, make sure you come to me or go to your dean before reacting to it, because unfortunately, what does the social media do? It glorifies how you respond to it. And the consequences are you end up meeting some of us. And that's after the fact, after we sat and explained to you, you know, how you should have handled it, but you reacted because of there's normally a crowd around that wants to see what's going to happen and what you're going to do about it versus handling it the right way.
Good answer, man. So cyberbullying further, what have you seen cyberbullying create in your school? Like, where did it come from? Was it, for example, was it issues with, like, say, maybe two guys liking the same young lady or something like that? What caused the cyberbullying? Any examples someone can provide?
This might be back when I was in middle school. This lady got her pictures leaked, and like even now people still talk about it, about the choices she made back when she was in middle school.
Okay. So something from the past that was replayed, and that person was bullied about a picture or something from the past. Anything else that created that? Did that create a situation where it caused a physical altercation?
Not with any altercation with anybody else, but she used to harm herself because she didn't like what she did in the past. Yeah.
That's deep. So the individual was thinking of harming themselves because they didn't like that reminder of the past. So, Joe.
Yeah, one of the things that I was just talking to the chief about is that during my day, that those particular issues, whatever I did stupid in 1983, it went away the following week when everyone's memory of it went away, or you know, what I did was not recorded to be replayed. The big difference is in my childhood and my father's childhood and the people before us is that when you guys make a mistake, if you do it in a public way, it could haunt you for years to come, depending on what it is you did, and that alone adds pressure. I know if I had some of the things replayed that I did just as a kid or just being foolish, it could be very harmful to myself or to others. So I think they have a little tough when it comes to that. I was just agreeing with them.
You guys have some challenges that we didn't have in that there was no social media. There was no, you know, there's VHS or beta, and you guys probably don't even know what that means, right? But there wasn't anything that I recorded on TikTok or something that I sent a selfie and then I had to live with that consequence, you know, essentially forever, right? Electronic data is out there forever. You guys have some challenges that we didn't have, and I applaud you guys for how you're handling those, but the root, though, is you need to think about, before I do this, before I say something, before I record this, what is the long-term consequence, right? What is the long-term effect that this could have? And that applies to a lot of things. It applies to, you know, when you're sending out photos, selfies, messages, anything like that. It also applies to how you treat other people. And even though you guys have some challenges we didn't have with technology, I think that root still kind of boils down to, you know, if and when I hit send on this, I can't bring this back. And if and when I say something careless to somebody, I can't untake that. Does that make sense to you guys?
So when I thought about this discussion, one of the big topics that stood out to me is the nightmare of having an active shooter situation at your school, right? You see that violence all around the world. And just to talk about that, what do you guys, like, please tell me, what do you guys think triggers a student or someone that you appear that you've gone to school with or you've seen in some of these other schools across the country to reach that breaking point where they feel like they got to take it out on their school and their student body? What do you think causes that?
No wrong answers. Really, it starts at home with like the parents and stuff. And then if you're going to school and then you got other kids talking about you, talking about your clothes, you smelling stuff, that really can like make them want to do stuff like that.
So low self-esteem, not feeling loved at home, not feeling like you have friends or support at school. Someone else?
Well, personal experience at AVM, I saw in the hallways people were making fun of this girl. So then the following week, and I'm not sure if any Romeoville PD might remember this incident, but she allegedly brought a gun to AVM, and then all the buses were stopped, everyone was rushed inside. So personally, what I think it is not liking what someone else says.
Not liking what someone else, anybody else? Okay, so before I give it to the panel and they'll help me with this, how do we handle that? As a, if you know of a peer or you know of someone having rumors or gossip about those type of situations, and not just here in Romeoville, like, if we were to look back at some of the situations that we've seen across the world, how would you advise that students handle that? What would you do?
I would tell that to an adult.
You would feel comfortable doing that? You wouldn't feel like a snitch? Smart, smart. Anyone else? I've seen a hand over there.
You could try to like take yourself away from the situation, like
kind of
stop talking to those people, stop talking to the people that are like saying that stuff or anything.
Understood. Go ahead.
I think personally, like as like seeing something that happens, I would try to make the person feel more accepted than what others may make them feel, because like maybe they might not feel accepted by the other peers that they may be around.
So you would try to friend them and make them accept it. So for my panel, what advice could you give them when they encounter situations where they may know a student is a threat to the whole school body and to the community?
I'm gonna go off of, what's your name? Noah. When people say that you're being a snitch because you're trying to actually help somebody. That is the first thing that we want you guys to do, and ladies, is to actually say something to a counselor or a dean, like Commander Anderson said, to actually speak up and say something. Because I'm sure, how many of you guys have sisters? I mean, that's almost the whole panel. Would you want somebody not to say something? You would be more upset if you didn't say anything. You know what I'm saying? You want somebody to say, speak up for your sister or for your lover or your other brother or whoever it is. So I would think the biggest thing is actually that taking that first step, acknowledging that this whatever is happening is not right, to go and tell someone. And like I like your answer also, kind of like, hey, it's gonna be okay. Hey, hang with me. Let's hang out with my crew or my group. This is my name, this is such and such. It kind of bring him in, feel warm and welcome into the school. So I would definitely be the first thing I would say is actually talk to somebody first.
Anybody else?
I don't need a mic, you know, I talk loud. So I grew up with metal detectors in my high school, which was normal for me. So I do know out here a lot of parents say that they don't like that. I don't know if there are metal detectors in the middle school or the high school, because I have an elementary school child. But what do you all think about metal detectors in the schools if they're not already there?
Well, what I can say, and I know I have a teacher here that works with me on the basketball program at RHS. RHS doesn't have metal detectors, but they have like certain days that are, I know when I used to be doing some volunteer or subbing work in there, they would have certain days where they would do, what do they call them?
Wand
checks. Yeah, and there are high schools within the community that do have metal detectors daily, but just not in Valley View schools. Okay.
I would say, you know, it would be lovely if we didn't have metal detectors in the school. That'd be lovely, but that's a pipe dream, and that's a genie that we're not gonna be able to put back in the bottle. Well, the way today's society is and the things that we see encountering across the country, we would be foolish to pretend like it could never happen here and go with that mentality until it happens here. So I think it, sometimes knowing what we know about the world today, we can work to make it better, but you have to have precautions in place. So when a budget allows or when you're able to or you feel that the cause is there, sometimes you have to have these things in these facilities. It is what it is. It's a sign of our times. And when we don't properly prepare, we prepare to fail. That's in everything in life. That's lessons for you in school, and that's general law of the world. So unfortunately, we do have to have those things in today's world. And we have it a lot more in Chicago because you see a lot more of the violence. It's a lot less of two household families, so that when mom can't knuckle down, there is actually a dad showing up. There's may not be organizations there like ours that catch these boys on the street, you know, and give them something to do and help them learn about themselves and how to work through these things. It's great when your community can have these things and they actually work together, but not everybody is as lucky as you guys are here that we're able to sit here and talk about these things. But I wouldn't be upset about the metal detectors. You got to understand if they do come in, whatever facilities you see it, they have to be there because of what safety.
Oh no, I'm good.
Okay, we good then.
How do you guys feel about metal detectors? Do you guys feel uncomfortable when you see them, or are you feeling safe? Are you okay with it? Like on the average, what do you think about something like that when they're presented at school? Anybody got anything?
I think, like, well, with me already being in Romeoville, I'm still kind of safe. I think I feel kind of safe, but I think with the metal detectors, it's just a little bit more reassurance than that I think, like, okay, I'm all right.
Guys, I got to meet several of you today and a lot of basketball players here. How many of you enjoy going to see the Bulls play at the United Center? How many of you would like to go see the White Sox play at Sox Park? The Cubs at Wrigley Field, and the Cubs at Wrigley Field, right? The Bears at Soldier Field. All right, so at some point in time, everybody has raised their hand. In every one of those venues, you're gonna walk through metal detector, and it's an ounce of prevention. And so if they were to come to your school for some reason, just accept it as the leadership of your community and your school is installing another ounce of prevention. Don't take it personally. I love going to the ball games, and anytime I go, either as a guest or if I might be working, I have to go through the metal detector to get in there, and I know that I'm going in there, and it's an ounce of prevention, and I'm going to have a good time for the next 4 to 5 or 6 hours, enjoy watching something that I truly love and enjoy.
I want to give one piece of advice.
One piece of advice to a lot of you guys that I'm going to see in and out of the schools, guys. Make a friend in the administration. What that means is might be a security officer, might be a coach. Over time, you'll get to know who you feel has a connection with you as you get to know them, and it might be the resource officer. Build a relationship, a real one, with an individual that you feel that you can trust, and those are the individuals. When you see something weird, hear something weird, you need to tell immediately. Those that you know are going to do something positive to deal with the issue. That's something, just as a personal piece of advice, I would, when you're going into the high schools, figure out who you feel you can trust. And when you see and hear things, let's get ahead of it. Talk to them.
Without being specific towards each situation or occurrence, my next question is, what are the things or the situations that you guys find yourself in today's daily, you know, world as being high school students that make you want to, like, become violent or physical or act out or maybe get into an altercation? Can anyone elaborate? What situations do you find yourself in that puts you in that mindset or that you've seen put you in a mindset like that? No wrong answer. We're all learning.
When people say disrespectful stuff.
Like, for example?
Like, somebody calls me ugly or something like that, or like something else offensive.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Good one. Anybody else?
I was saying, for me, I get irritated pretty bad. Like mm-hmm. I like be irritated and like disrespectful thing.
So what do you feel like? You feel like you got a...
Oh, yeah.
I just feel like... I don't know.
Well, no wrong answer. We learning from each other.
Yeah. So, like, I think like, if you call like, a B-word, like, you be disrespectful. I just feel like we should check it out.
We should check it out. Anybody else?
She has some words about this.
Two of them over there.
That's the big thing right there. It's all about reputation.
Sometimes, everybody got and this is probably going to be at RHS too, but people just pushing you for no reason, for bumping into you for no reason.
Crowd in your space. Mm.
People saying, like, disrespectful stuff to some of my friends or something like that, but like, make me feel sometimes worried about them.
So you want to support your friends and help your friends?
Talking about somebody's dead relative.
Oh, talking about a family member that's passed. Yeah. So when you find yourself in that situation and you know it's to this point that you know what, I wanna check it out, as Corey said, right? What are some of the things? Is it just no thinking, no, you know, 0 to 100, I'm ready to act, I'm ready to pounce, or is there a process that's playing out? Like, are you talking yourself through before you get to that point? Can anybody elaborate on that? How does that work? Because, you know, things have changed since I was a teenager, and I know some of the things and situations I found myself in, but can anybody elaborate how they handle that?
Probably like think about a scenario of what could happen, like if you did act on it, but you don't really think about like the outcome of like what could happen, like the consequences of what could happen if you actually did something. Like that.
That's a good answer.
Personally, whenever something happens, I address whatever just happened, whoever I'm talking to, and then if they try to like attack me or try to hit me,
get somebody. Okay, anybody else?
I feel like, so if like if somebody's face to face with me, I might not think, I might react. Like if it's over social media, I feel like I might have
time to think about it, think about the outcome if I do something stupid out of anger.
Especially nowadays, right? Because when you react, someone's pulling out that phone, right? And it's regardless if it's arguing or fighting, they got it all out there for everyone to see. So you got to think. But how many, and I've been guilty of this when I was younger, how many of you have said in those situations, I don't care? Raise your hand, right? But after the I don't care and you act out, you're like, dang, I shouldn't have did that. Right? So tell me about that. How does that feel when you go from I don't care to I shouldn't have did that? What's the thoughts when you say I shouldn't have did that? Go ahead.
Sometimes I just, like, after I think about it, like, after I get, like, the consequences happen, I sit in my room, I'm like, that was dumb.
No, no. Yeah. Right here. No, you got it. He took it. He took it. Noel. Everybody know what a big homie is? A mentor, a role model, a voice.
Personally, I think of myself as like a big homie. Like, if things happen, I feel like I'll like talk them out of the situation or be like, nah, don't do that, just move around. Or be like, there's always haters or someone that's gonna talk bad about you. And like, if you try and deal with all the haters, you'll never get to where you're trying to be at. So that's why I think of it like that. Yes. So I try to like make sure everybody's cool, key down, and like dissolve the situation.
Level head.
My question, is there a little homie?
A little homie, ain't nothing wrong.
So, go ahead, right there.
Me personally, my big homies is my coaches, like Coach Mark, Coach Ken, especially Coach John. We got that bond.
Correct.
On both sides. So we can keep for us, keep it under control, we gotta know. If the queen is a big homie, then queen, what's going on tonight? What's happening at 3 o'clock?
Correct. Absolutely. Absolutely.
We all know from at 3 o'clock and get down at 3, we need to be on site at 3 o'clock.
Yeah. And some of us on the panel have had those conversations before because we're in tune with the guys. But just to elaborate on what he's saying about having someone that can be that big homie role or just talking them through. So now, panel, how can we talk them through of not reacting? Give them some advice.
We'll start with him. Well, number one, the word snitch. When you come to me with information to keep you guys safe, I see that as leadership qualities, not a snitch. So some of the, I know that's the fad, but they I think as long as you have someone to go to, build that rapport with them, as we stated earlier, and I know I'm wearing a badge, but it's important for me to be able to have that conversation with them and build up that relationship so they feel comfortable coming to me, coming to whoever the officer is assigned to the school. So when you have that relationship, we can get things accomplished together. And you see that it works with the social workers, with the teachers, with the deans. We all communicate to keep one another safe.
It's back to again that the whole snitching thing. When you got those big homies that say in place, it's actually not snitching. There's some leaders that's just say in our organization that grew up with you guys that are still running with some of you guys in this room today, and they're able to take on a lot of the things that happen in the community. They're how I or Pastor Chris or Commander Anderson learn about certain things on the street. So you're not actually being a snitch. If you do hear or see something, and you guys are pretty lucky because you got coaches and stuff, and it's not this, that way for every kid in the school system. But you have friends, you need to talk. You need to be able to communicate to who the big homie is so that individual can talk to the coach and talk to the commander so we can get these issues handled in our community. You know, I'll be the snitch then. I pay taxes here. You know, there's issues that I have to face that are in our society. And as a grown adult man, I'll face those things, but I need to know what's going on with my youth and those that cost me a little bit more tax dollars here and there because of what may or may not be happening properly at home. And if we're all gonna be honest here, we tiptoe around it, but a lot of it is exactly a result of what we're dealing with in society is exactly what's happening. It's because of what's going on or not going on at home and or in your personal life, which is okay. We all can't have a wonderful upbringing. But one thing I tell all my boys in program, whether you had a great upbringing or a bad one, there's going to come a time, God willing, and you breathing and continue to live where you're going to hit this number called 18. And in the state of Illinois, you're grown. They don't care whether daddy came home drunk and smacked you around every day or any other issue. At 18, you're going to have to be responsible for yourself. So you're going to have to make steps to get with the right people, to get the right mentoring, the right career choices. You can tell when someone cares for you and it's not just about some, you know, little light stuff that they truly care about you. You know, it's Wednesday. I could think of 100 things on that beautiful weather out there that I could do today. Why think about kids? I'm an old man. I ain't got to worry about you no more. Heck, stop taking the tax dollars out of there. I worry about it. Ain't none of my kids. All my kids are 21 and older. That's not how life works. It's a society thing, and we all got to participate. So even as young as you are, you got to participate. And your part is right now, you know, the idiots that's making the bad decisions. So it's your job to let people like me, Pastor Chris, your coaches, know so that we can do the right things, and I'll carry the snitch banner. Call me Coach Snitch.
All right, no problem. One thing that I see, because I was you. I had an extreme anger issue problem. I went from 0 to 100 within like 1 second. You said something wrong, I reacted, I did everything. Don't mistake the fact that I sit before you now as a pastor. To make you think that I haven't gone through. I grew up on the west side of Chicago, like a couple of people have said, here and here today, and I did everything that I was big and bad enough to do. But when I began to understand why, and that's what I think we don't take the time to help you guys to understand and identify, why is it that it's so easy for you to go from 0 to 100 so quick? Why is it so easy for you to get bumped and you ready to fight? You know what I'm saying? When I've been working in the Valley View School District, I've noticed that you guys deal with stuff that I didn't deal with until I was almost in high school or college. And a lot of y'all are dealing with stuff in middle school. You seeing stuff in middle school that I didn't deal with until I was almost grown. You see what I'm saying? So it's forever in front of you. And so for you guys to be able to carry that weight and then go home and not have a release, and then people are trying to tell you that you got to act this way and act that way, that's hard. It's like you putting more powder into this time bomb, and I'm ready to blow up because nobody, as my brother just talked about, being that big homie, I got to take the time to sit down and not tell you what I want you to do, but listen to you to see where you are. Because the only way that I can help you and the only way that we can come to grips and I can be your big homie is if you trust me enough to tell me what's really going on. Not that I've sat in front of many adults, right? And we tell them just what they want to hear. We know we're going to talk for about 35 minutes to an hour. I'm going to tell you exactly what you want to hear. And then I'm going to go on about my business. And they don't really care about what I want to say, right? But when you get somebody that wants to sit down with you and spend that time with you so that you can start talking about, man, this is what I'm dealing with at home. This is what I'm dealing with at school. People saying this, people saying that. I've dealt with kids that didn't even want to go home. They wanted to spend their whole day at school because they knew when they went home, all of the chaos that they was going to have to deal with. But I want to commend you, as Chief said earlier, I want to commend you guys because a lot of times as adults, we don't really respect what the weight that you guys have to carry. And so when people don't have a voice, that's when violence comes. When people don't have a voice and they feel that people are not listening to me, and so that's what I wrote down. So we got to be able to give you guys positive outlets that you can come and be open and be free without any persecution. I'm not judging you. How can I judge you knowing what I've been through? And we got to be real with you. Man, I done sold drugs. I done got high. I done did this. I done stole. I done gangbanged. I done did it all. Thank the Lord I never had to go through and stay in the penitentiary system, but I was like this close to getting there. So I understand what you guys are going through. I grew up, I watched my father raise a whole nother family. I understand the frustrations as young adults that we deal with and people looking at you and say, why are you acting out? Because nobody listening to me. Why are you snapping off at school? Because don't nobody understand what I'm dealing with. I'm trying to talk to my people at home that say they love me, but nobody hearing me. They keep telling me to shut up and go to my room. So now I'm filled with anger. I'm filled with frustration. I'm filled with all of this anxiety, and I'm ready to lash out on whoever comes at me. So my thing is, how can we build up healthy lines of communication? I know it's not enough of us to go after everybody. But I do understand that if I can set up a relationship with somebody and I can give you and help you make it, now you can go help somebody else. And then that person can go help somebody else. But somebody has to be willing to sit down and be honest. And it starts with us, as you say, it starts with the big homies. Because, see, I had people that was on the block that told me, hey, young dude, go to school. You've been on the block too long. Get up out of here. Get back to the house. We don't have that no more. Because it was a shift, and now we started saying, well, you're not going to get a lot of jail time. You can stay on the block. But that's the truth. They're not going to take it. They might take the drugs from you. You're not going to do no jail time, though. So I'm going to put you. And so we didn't care about your future. So now we got to make up where we messed up. And those of us who the Lord has blessed to get out of that life, now we got to come back and sow into y'all young brothers without bias, without looking down on y'all and saying, look, bro, I know what you're going through. I've been here. And then the key word to all this, and I'm done, is that we have to be consistent. I'm not just doing this because we on camera. I'm doing this because I love you. And I don't want you to turn out like I did. I don't want you to waste 25 years of your life like I did. Amen. I don't want you to break your family's hearts. I don't want you to have your mother up late night crying because you out here running in these streets and she don't know whether or not you're going to come home or not. And then I want you to realize that you are loved. Sometimes I didn't get the love I wanted from my father, but I had to find that love from somebody else. Sometimes we don't get it from where we want it from, right? But we can't allow that to close our hearts down, and we get anger. And now we ready. It's me against the whole world, and I'm ready to fight the whole world. It's people out here that love y'all, and you just got to give these brothers a chance. Whether they got a badge on, these brothers love y'all. They want to see the best for y'all. Or whether it's me with a collar on, or if it's Coach Joe with a basketball in his hand, right? You got to understand there's brothers out here that's ready to put that work in and spend time with you, and we got an ear to listen to what you're going through.
Well said, well said. And that's the direction we want to go in as we start wrapping up. I think Pastor covered it all just right there. What I wanted to talk to you guys about as we close it out, we did a good job talking about violence and how we should handle it and some of the experiences we've encountered. But where I want to address it now is you see our diverse panel. You see we have officers, pastors, coaches. But just to speak specifically on the officers, we got a, you know, what do you call it, multicultural audience of student athletes. But look at our panel, our diversity in our panel. I know many of you. The next question is, how do you view law enforcement? Are you intimidated by law enforcement? Do you see them as a good thing or a bad thing? What's your views on law enforcement? Someone give me, what is your thoughts? When you see the police, do you feel like you're safe or do you feel nervous? What do you feel? Good answer. Anyone else? What'd you say was the first one?
Helping and helping solve the issue. Figure out what's going on. Helping solve the issue.
All right. Anyone else? What did he say I didn't hear? Well, and then before I add to the next part and let the panel talk, many times in the minority community, we don't feel that the police are safe, right or wrong? Would you guys, anybody agree with that statement? That we don't feel that it's a sign of safety. Would anybody agree with that? Why do you think that is the case?
Because
usually, when the police come around, they always think it's something bad happens or
it's not
going to
go well or things like that. When they,
so
think about the problem, think about all the negative.
So you're saying that they look at us as negative? I'm asking you, is that what you're saying? So you don't want me to get you in trouble, huh? He's smooth with it, ain't he? Okay. Anybody else before I let these gentlemen talk? All right. So, with that being the case, I just wanted to give the different points of views so I can let them talk about it. But before I pass them the mic, I want you to take a good look at our officers that we have here. Officers, how many are you are young minority officers? Or you're still young, raise your hand. All right, so we have three minority officers and then we have a Caucasian officer. But what I'm trying to show you guys is we have a diverse group of officers. And these guys are doing this job, right? And they've been raised and brought up the same way as some as you. But they're doing this job and it's a great career, right? And it's something that I know, for instance, all of the officers here are former athletes, right or wrong, officers? Former athletes, right, that took on this challenge. That's a difficult challenge to protect and serve. So I want you guys to really look at that and take a look at that, that some of them sat in your roles when they were 15, 16, 17, and 18 and chose this job to protect you. So sometimes we have to take that into consideration when we're passing judgment on them, despite what color they are. So we have to be, what do you call it, open-minded as well. But I'm going to let them talk about that. Go ahead.
What I want to say, if I can just close another question, this is it. My question is this. How many of y'all know anybody in the captain? Who do you know in the captain?
Big A.
Which one?
It's right there. Commander, as I should say.
Which one?
Commander Anderson.
That's you. How comfortable do you feel talking to Commander Anderson?
On a scale of 1 to 10. 10.
Why?
Because he always gave me great advice, and until we passed him, he wanted to tell me fast, he always lift me up. So if I do something wrong, he'll immediately correct me because he knows that I'm a good kid all around, and he knows that I make some poor decisions. And when I was in Joliet Central, he used to help me. Him and Larry used to help me go get a job and things like that. So every time I used to have a problem, I always called him, I always text him, check up on him, things like that, because I know what he did for me when I was in Joliet Central.
Yes. Who else did they have somebody? You know. You got the same.
Was that the right? So, and then we'll wrap it up, but I will let each officer on the panel specifically speak towards how you can build better relationships with them.
All right. Well, I'm from Villa Park Police, so I have a different community. So I am the big A or the big D in Villa Park. And actually, me and Commander Anderson went to school, we went to college together. I'm a student athlete. He's a student athlete. At one point, I had an opportunity to play overseas in Turkey before I had an ACL injury. So I went back to the high school once I finished, thinking I was going to go to the league, get a little 10-day contract and play, and it didn't happen. So my whole direction in life had to change, and my brother's CPD, 29 and a half years, retired. I didn't want to be the police. I wasn't thinking about the police. I was playing ball. I'm dunking fools on the court, trying to go to AAUs and playing in summer league tournaments and stuff like that. I was just like you guys, a gym rat every day, playing in different parks, playing with different groups of people. So when it finally got to the opportunity to be an adult, like Pastor said, now I got to change. I'm 18, I'm 21 now, I'm on my own, I'm a grown adult. What am I going to do with my life? Basketball is not going to always be there for all you guys. I'm going to be honest with you. It's one in a million, all right? One of you guys or two of you guys might make it and go to play on Division III, Division II, Division I college ball. That's just the reality of it. But what you do with that time and how you interact with the police, once I had the opportunity to talk with my brother, who's close, to ask him questions. The one thing you guys had that I didn't have, and everybody else can agree with that, we didn't have school resource officers when I was in high school. We had deans. That was it. We had, I had one dean in the whole high school. So that was one person that we would had to go talk to. I didn't have police officers in the school. So you guys have a tool that can help you bridge that gap between police and student or student athletes to ask questions. So my question to you guys is actually, it's a two-way street. Just like you said, you don't want to be treated, and we grown men. So you want to get respected. I've always give people the respect first. It's your job to lose it because I don't know you. I don't know nobody up here. I can't say I'm going to disrespect you because I don't know nothing about you. You might be a great person, so I'm going to give you that respect. It's how that relationship and how you receive us, be talking back to us. Hey, you come off like you're talking with some sense. I'm going to talk like I got some sense also. How you come back me, I'm going to come back. So how you have that choice on how you – your relationship with the police. That's out on the street. And while you're in school, you have an opportunity to say, okay, hey, I just got pulled over by this police officer, Commander Anderson. How did I, I said this and he still was kind of this way with me. But no, what, did I do something wrong? No, you probably didn't do something wrong. Just like all teachers are not, you know, all teachers are not bad. All pastors, all fire chiefs, all police chiefs, all officers, doctors, lawyers, everybody's not bad. It's just your relationship and how you perceived it to be, how you come off and how we respect you and you respect us. And it's like the halfway street. I know that sometimes the uniform can be intimidating. I came in soft clothes on purpose because I know that's how I was at the high school. I used to be the school resource officer in Willowbrook High School in Villa Park. And that was my thing. I had people come up to me, they called me Uncle Daddy because of my relationship with my community and my students, student athletes and kids, just like you, how you felt comfortable coming up to me. I would have four or five people sitting in my office. Don't you gotta go to class? Go on, get out of my office. They just wanted to sit down and talk. So I opened myself up. Now that particular SRO has to be a special person too. Commander D is a special person. Pastor, all these individuals up here are special because we want to be here to help you move on in life in a positive manner because we have been through it. I have my own situations. We'd be up here for another 2-3 hours. I'm not going to do that. But I just want to let you guys know that I was, and myself, Commander Anderson, was in your shoes years ago, thinking the same way. It's just a little different. Ain't nothing changed, it's just a little different. And we have a lot more experience to be able to help you get through those tough times when it comes down to it. All right, I'm sorry, I'm gonna keep going.
I got jotted down a couple things that I don't want to forget. Number one, I want you guys to know that see past the badge. You know, see us as a resource. That's what I consider myself to you. Yes, I've been in your shoes. I've had a bad experience growing up with a police officer, and guess what? I thank God for it because it made me a better police officer. Because I know how to treat people. I know how to treat you. I know how to look beyond people calling you just bad kids. Because I want to get to the root of the problem. I understand because I come from somewhat the same environment. I've done some of the same things you guys have done. There's a lot of life experience up here. Use your resources. You want to go on to play college ball? Talk to us sometime. We'll share some stories with you. Because there are certain things that you can't do now that will come back to bite you, like we can revert back to social media. I was assigned to an alternate school. And that's where I developed this passion. I knew this was my calling because I have to be your voice. I want to be your voice. I want you to be able to call me anytime you need me. But I also work with individuals that would do the exact same thing. You know, they glorify the negative stuff in social media and in the media, but that doesn't reflect some of the people that I work with that would die for you. Another thing, if I had looked at my bad experience that I had with the police And I don't care what profession it is that you choose. Pick someone's brain that's in that profession. Don't go off what everyone else thinks. Don't go off what you see in social media and go and do it 10 times better. If you want to be a police officer, I want you to be 10 times better than me, so I'm gonna show you tell you about the do's and the don'ts. All right, so by a show of hands, how many of you are driving? To have your license. Don't be, I'm not gonna pull you over.
To have your permit.
Yeah. Well.
I've been driving for a long time.
Yeah, right. Since I was 13, huh?
Right.
Oh, yeah, most definitely. The reason I ask that is because Chief and I have some pamphlets here on what to do when you get stopped by the police. If you don't want to come to me personally, take this home, read it, because we don't want worst case scenario. You know, my mom is a part of a club that I don't want any of your parents to be a part of burying a child. Okay? That's worst case scenario. I don't want worst case scenario for you guys. And any time I can give you any piece of advice, I'm here for you. So please keep that in mind. If you don't know me, get to know me. Get to know these guys. I'll give you my card. Use us as a resource. Thank you.
I won't go too long. A couple of things that I heard tonight. I think the most brilliant thing that I heard this evening, Coach Joe said, and that is pick somebody out. Pick out somebody you want to model. Pick out a teacher, a coach, a counselor, an officer. Pick out somebody that you like. Somebody you like to hang out with, somebody you trust, and develop a relationship with that person, build a rapport with that person, because that person, whether it's somebody on this panel here, or it's a teacher at your school, or it's a guidance counselor, or a coach, somebody that's got a positive influence on your life, they're going to be there for you if you need to talk to them about something difficult, or God forbid, we talked early on about, you know, the horrible things that happen with school shootings, see something, say something. Put that burden on that person. That person, if you've built that relationship, built that rapport, that person's going to go do the next right thing on your behalf. And so I think that was probably the most brilliant thing that I heard this evening. Pick out somebody you like and know that they're a good person and model that behavior. And then be involved in something positive. And I saw you guys involved in a lot of basketball, right? So I'm going to stick with basketball here. Be involved in something positive. It doesn't have to be athletics. It can be church. It can be music. It can be clubs or something like that. But be involved in something positive and live up to those expectations. Live up to those expectations. And we as adults and leaders in this community, and myself as a police chief, I expect you guys to make mistakes. I expect teenagers to make mistakes. We all expect you to make mistakes. Those are teaching moments. You have those small course corrections and keep moving on, and then you will be sitting on this side of the microphone someday talking to somebody who looks just like you and is a lot thinner and can run and jump still. But because pick out somebody you trust, live up to the expectations of something positive in your life.
And I'm going to keep it moving too, but I want to jump on to something that Chief just said. After you pick out that guy and you're doing the work of building the relationship where you can tell someone, once you mature and you're at a point where you think you can take up a leadership role, you do have a responsibility. You know, and it goes back to, all my kids are over 21, so why am I even bothering with you? It's because you have to be vested in wherever you live, work, and you spend your time. And so what I would say is, once you're mature enough, then you, I got this thing that I've been doing with my friends and stuff that we call Just 12. Get some guys that you're responsible for. And if you can, if you're mature enough, let one of them even be your Judas. Meaning that guy that you may not always see eye to eye with, or for whatever reason you haven't had the opportunity to get to know each other better. and you check up behind that person. If we all do that, we can cover a lot of our friends. What we do in our program is some of my older guys are responsible for 5 or 6 guys. Me personally, in my life, there's at least 12 men that I daily send a message to, a text, a phone call, or something to encourage them. Because we go through stuff as adults that it's a whole nother thing about where men can go and talk about things and have a safe place. That's what I do with some of these guys that's up here on this panel, where we discuss issues in our life so that we able to give you good advice. I would say once you're mature, start looking out for some of your friends. Look out for 4 or 5 of them. Keep up behind them. Y'all all know Teddy's stupid and he does very stupid things. Stay up behind him. Yeah, they know. Everybody in here know a Teddy. So let Teddy know. You know, yo, dude, we can't be doing this. This is not how we roll. You'll be surprised how many Teddies you save in your lifetime. You know, when they peers start calling them on their bull, they straighten out most of the time unless they were just meant to go down the path anyway. And you're going to lose a few of them. There's nothing that you're not going to save every person, but we have to make the effort to educate one another. So that's what I would say. Make sure once you get help that you be that light and that source for the next one behind you.
All right. You guys got a lot of information today, right? A lot of times that, you know, we hear stuff, but, you know, we listen, but do we really hear what's being said? And the last thing that I want to say to you guys is dealing with the relationship first on how I felt with the police. It just depended on what I was doing at the time. Amen. It depended on where I was. If you're doing something bad, you don't want to see the police, right? But if you're doing what you're supposed to do, you don't care if you got a relationship with the police because you're living the way you're supposed to live. So everything that we've said to you, we can speak it until we're blue in the face, but it all boils down. This is your choice. This is your life, and you only got one life to live. And it's either we gonna buy into what we see on social media, we gonna buy into the songs that we live in, half the people that's singing half of these rap songs or whatever, and I'm a hip-hop head, so I'm not down to none of that. But a lot of that stuff they talking about is not real, it's not true. And we trying to live images that aren't real. So you got a choice to say, this is my life, I only got one life to live. I've seen if I go this way, I can end up here. It's only 2 ways we can go. It's either you're going to be successful or you're going to jail. So it's either you're going to be successful and you're going to have these men sitting there, hey, man, I remember you, congratulations, or they're going to be coming to your house and putting you in handcuffs and taking you away. But that's not their choice. That comes off your choice. So you got to choose today. Say, look, my life is worth a lot more. I don't care what nobody said about my life. I don't care what none of the haters are saying about me. I don't care if they say I can't hoop. They say I'm not smart or whatever. I know who I am. So you got to make that decision that when the police see me, they're not going to see me for nothing bad. They're going to see me because they coming to my graduation and they seeing me graduate from high school. They seeing me graduate from college, or they seeing me start a business in the community, and they got the mayor coming and they doing ribbon cuttings and I'm being a very productive part of my community. But it all boils down to, what are you going to do? We can do these things every day, but if you leave here and still make the same bad choices, you're going to see these guys in the light that you don't want to see them. You understand what I'm saying? And trust me, you don't want to be in a 6x6 or an 8x8 with somebody telling you when you're supposed to eat or telling you when you're supposed to take a shower or telling you when you can call. So don't take your life for granted. Understand that there is greatness on the inside of each and every one of you. All of y'all are great. You just got to find out where you're great at. Amen.
I like you too, man. That's my guy right there.
Just to kind of like piggyback on what these guys are saying, before I was a police officer, I used to work in the juvenile detention center. People ages all around looking like you guys from like 10 to 17 and whatnot. And I can just remember the struggle that they've been through and whatnot. They just always said it was like a lack of support at home. And I remember you saying that could be one of the questions earlier, was the lack of support at home. So with that being said, you got to kind of reach out to them and use them as a support or an outlet that you guys can go to. And I believe that it's going to start with you guys the younger generation to change the media, change the portray the image that we have as police officers and whatnot. And I'm trying to get out there in the community and whatnot. And I always, whenever I'm patrolling, try and get out there, shoot some hoops with the guys at the park and whatnot, and just show that it's more to a badge. We're still human, just like you guys. We still go home when we have families and kids and stuff, not so. Just kind of keep that in the back of your mind. So we want to help change the community and help the community as much as you guys want to see change. So.
All right, we're going to get a message from Mayor Noak here.
Thank you. I was just really here to listen tonight more than anything. I want to start by just thanking all of you. None of these programs can even be successful if we don't listen and hear from you. So the more you tell us what you're thinking and experiencing, the better. Because that's ultimately what it's really about. These things will be successful if they're driven by you. I kind of find it funny, you brought up the topic of social media, and let's see here. You know, probably every day I get cyberbullied. Did you know that? And there's actually this funny meme they put up that mommy's busy right now, son, and she's cyberbullying the mayor. It's kind of a joke somebody put up around communities. And in fact, I think I'm probably being cyberbullied right now. But we face that when we're older, and you guys have so many things that challenges that were unique from us and our experiences being younger. You know, you heard tonight about making mistakes and how people have made mistakes in their lives. You know, I've made mistakes, and they've been hard to overcome and move beyond. But what I want to say is that life isn't just about your mistakes. It's not even just about your successes. It is about all the things you do to recover, how you address them, how you own them, how you move forward. You know, one thing I appreciate about your generation, and I see this even in my son, who's a little younger, is I see it every day. I've seen many instances of this compassion, and I see it in your generation. And I heard it a little bit here, when you identify those other kids that had issues and knowing that, you know, that they were getting cyberbullied or whatever it might be. It's so important that, you know, we realize that and we reach out and we help each other. And, you know, life is going to continue to throw those. There are going to be challenges. And how you overcome them is vitally important. I know quite a few of you probably were, does anybody remember being at DARE when there were a DARE program? Come on, all right, there's a few of you. And whatever school that might have been at the time. And this is starting to make me feel a little bit old, you know. Now, I really challenge you. Do any of you remember me reading to you in first grade? Oh, there we go. Was it Moose and the Muffin? It was. Yeah, there we go. Yeah, the mayor's starting to feel a little old right now. But, you know, if you remember this at DARE, and I said this then, that when I came and I talked, is if one thing you left that program with was understanding that there are people who care about you. And I really meant it then. I meant it when I was reading about the Moose and the Muffin, too. But I mean it now, too. And I think everybody here means that you're important to us. Your lives are important to us, your success, being there and your failures, all of it is important to us. So I want to leave you that, yeah, I'm definitely not a big homie. I'm pretty short. I mean, that's quite true. I've always been short. It's not new. You know, we're here for you. And even if we don't get super close, don't ever hesitate. If there's some challenge, there's something you're worried about, there's somebody you just need to reach out for, we're here. I mean, I put my phone number out there to the world. If you can't find anyone else, you find my cell phone. I'll give it to you before we leave. You know, we got to be here for each other. And I'm just so grateful that you were able to share this time and share your experiences with us. And I just want to thank you again, because it's so important. Thank you.
All right, we want to thank the mayor. We want to thank all our guests from our panel for coming out. Thank our athletic department, Noel Maldonado, Kelly Reiser, for supporting us and allowing us to do this Opportunity Matters event. And for all my students, athletes, and individuals here, please, before you leave, shake everyone's hand on the panel. Thank them for coming out. They have some really good information about how you, you know, conduct yourself on a traffic stop. Make sure you get that. When this is over, if you guys want to hang out and get some shots up and you know, do some things around here, you're welcome to. All right? Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Have a good night.